you spin something, its energy is largely planar, even when it's moving around. It's useful for us to think of the rotational energy as planar, having an axis. Anything planar has two sides. Given a direction of spin, I can either be on this back side of it, this side, where my wrist is driving the spin, is spinning clockwise, or I can be on the other side of it, where my wrist is spinning anti-clockwise to drive the exact same motion. That's kind of one of the first principles of how all of this stuff stacks up. So because there are two sides, I like to think of what I'm talking about as plane facings, as you're flipping your wrist. It's that your controlling hand is holding on to the poi and spinning it on a plane, and that's facing in a particular direction. It's like when you're holding a pinwheel is spinning, but also facing one direction or another. So I can be holding my poi here and spinning a certain way, and the plane facing is facing out away from my hand that way. Or I can be on the other side of the spin plane, holding on, controlling it, driving it here, and the spin plane is facing that way. And that is a reflective axis. There's, with our poi, with our body spinning the poi, with how two poi interact, a lot of the important parts of how patterns interact have to do with reflective axes and which side you're on, which way you're facing, how they relate. With one of those other videos I linked, I was talking about bounding box or bounding hallway. If it's a plane that's intersecting your body, there's only certain places you can spin safely before you intersecting yourself and hitting yourself. So there's a safe boundary plane on one side of an object, like a human body or even just an arm. There's another plane on the other side. This is a safe boundary plane that is parallel, if we're keeping to a fairly parallel plane spinning analogy without doing crazy atomic or plane bending yet. So essentially, whenever I'm spinning on a boundary plane, my plane facing is facing out to that boundary plane, kind of touching that boundary plane. And we do some helical spiraling movement with cross points or whatnot to get from boundary plane to boundary plane. That can be big on either side of your body, but it could also be little. It could just be the difference between being on one side of your arm to the other side of your arm, or one side of your arm to the other side of your arm, or one side of your arm to the other side of your arm. So we have macro and micro, but the same principle always applies. You can have one big outside plane, or one big outside plane. You can also have a microcosmic inside plane. This plane facing is synonymous with that macro, that other big macro plane facing. So this is synonymous with this, or this. Everything to do with poi is, it's control coming from your torso, particularly your shoulder girdles, your shoulder girdle, out through the arms to the hand to the poi. That's the direction the control flows. The poi is floppy and passive, and we're controlling it. Emanating outward from the shoulder girdle, from the center of this armature. So it's kind of like a big puppy hammer. It's like one big meteor, really. So I have, this is kind of a model of that. Right, so this is the shoulder girdle. The shoulder girdle can be oriented in different ways. The arms have a certain range of motion. They go out to the wrists, which are used to point the plane facings in different directions. So it's always important while you're playing with your poi and thinking about where they're going in space, whether it's big macroscopic patterns or tiny little inside in inside out inverted patterns or whatever, to pay attention to your spin plane's orientation to the shoulder girdle. Is it perpendicular to the shoulder girdle? Is it parallel with the shoulder girdle? One way to think of this is when we come back to a neutral, natural state, we're not all contorted up. We can get twisted up and contorted, we reach a limit, we're going to have to undo that and come back to our neutral state to go somewhere else. So that's kind of like the central state, is the neutral untwisted state. And so between the shoulder girdle and the arms, this creates a plane. It's a plane that can be twisted, but it actually, it defines, it insinuates a plane. this is a linear orientation somewhere in space, and my arms in relation to it, whether I'm making them circular or very angular, it doesn't really matter. They insinuate a plane. Right now, the plane is parallel to your viewing plane. Right now, it's perpendicular, but my shoulders are still horizontal or parallel with the floor. Now it's perpendicular to you, but I've tilted my shoulders perpendicular to the floor. Now it's parallel to your viewing plane, but my shoulders are perpendicular to the floor. So we have different orientations that we go through or partway through with the shoulders and arms in 3D space that I think a lot of people overlook. I want to break it all the way down to a position that largely keeps the spin plane parallel with the shoulder girdle. So that's corkscrew or a mill, you know, whether it's a water mill or windmill or face mill or hip mill, and they're all basically doing the same thing. So mills are kind of less complicated than weaves in how the twisting of the arms and poi relate to the symmetry of the shoulder girdle, which is in fact where the control and the definition of symmetry and move comes from. So this is an important point. Like, we take it for granted, but almost everything we do in poi is defined by symmetry. If you really look for it, everything that's going on with poi tends to be oriented around some sort of symmetries. And then as we do more complicated, hybrid, composited, whatever variants on those, we tend to cause asymmetries as related to the more natural, basic seeing symmetry patterns. And that's where the complexity arises out of poi, no matter where you look, once you really start looking for it. To start showing plane facing stacking and plane facing combinations that result in inversions and whatnot, I just want to do it to start from a corkscrew. It's basically parallel with the armature, with the loop that the armature creates. So the armature plane is roughly parallel with the poi spin planes, and that makes things simple. When I'm doing a 2B corkscrew, there's no twisting in its most natural position. So I'm actually going to touch on the stuff that Arashi and I have been thinking about for a while before I get into the other stuff, and that's cross points. That you can have a cross point. Naturally, we tend to point our cross points out away from the shoulder girdle, but you can also have cross points pointing in towards the armature. As you can see, the cross point is pointing out away from me, out away from my shoulder girdle, out away from my armature. When I look down on it, I'm spinning kind of counterclockwise, which means that by definition, my right hand has to lead the left hand through that outward pointing cross point. So yellow poi is the leader being chased by blue. Because this is a 2B move, leader doesn't change through the cross point. It's using this one cross point. But I can switch to a different cross point with one, the other, or both poi. So what if I want to use an inward pointing cross point for the yellow poi? I can change things up. Now, the yellow poi is pointing in at my chest with an inward pointing cross point, while the blue poi is pointing out. Back to both are out. I could instead bring the blue in. Blue is the inward pointing poi, yellow is pointing out. And finally, I could bring both in. So this is still a 2B corkscrew, but both poi, we're now using an inward pointing cross point pointing in at my chest. And when you switch from one cross point sight to the opposing cross point sight, the leader through the cross point changes when you're doing it in split time. So it ended up switching so that blue is the one that is leading, whereas the outward pointing cross point in this case, yellow, is the one that's leading. You'll notice that the crossover timing changed when I changed from both using a single cross point to using two opposing cross points. That's because if I'm spinning in split time, where the poli are always pointing, opposing each other to opposite phases of the circle they're moving around. That's what defines the sequence or rhythm through which you go through cross point. If your spin plane timing and direction is split time, same direction, they're spinning in split time, they chase each other one after the other through a single cross point, and they do so half a rotation out of phase. So one poi hits the cross point, and then half a turn later, the other poi hits the cross point. However, if you're using two opposing cross points, then you can actually hit those two cross points at the same time in split time, because they're already pointing in opposite directions at that moment. So you've all probably done this sort of stuff, going from front plane to back plane through two different cross points at the same time, even though they're spinning split time same direction, or one in front, one behind, jigging the poi so that they, in that case, they're switching from two different sites opposing each other and crossing through two different cross points at the same time. That's exactly what's going on here as well. So when I switch to yellow in, blue out, one's high, one's low, they're actually hitting two cross points together, hitting two cross points together, like so. So again, that looks like this. Notice how they move up and down opposing each other so that they hit the cross points basically at the same time. But I can assure you, the planar spin is split time. There's progression of, you know, 2-beat corkscrew, 4-beat corkscrew adding a degree of twist, 6-beat corkscrew adding yet another degree of twist. You have all that with inward pointing cross points as well. So here we have inward pointing 2-beat, inward pointing 4-beat. Twist, the leader changed, and we're pointing 6-beat as well. And it just so happens that because my arms are having to curve back around, they meet here, that closing of the loop means I'm having to roll my wrist and do a barrel roll. I could attach my arms and move them around and connect them there. It would be like I'm standing here. Here we are. I'm facing that way, using a cross point pointing that way. The yellow is leading with this 4-beat. It's not barrel rolling inside my arms, because my arms are on the other side. My armature is opposing the cross point. If I switch it up, same configuration, yellow is closer to the camera, blue is not as close, but my body has switched over here, and I still do, yellow is leading, cross point is pointing that way, just like it was before spatially, but my body's on the other side of it. Now the cross point is pointing at my armature, it's pointing at the shoulder. That's essentially what Arashi was originally talking about when he was talking about insides or inside leaves or inside corkscrews or mills or whatever. He was talking about that the cross point is pointing in at the body, the armature loop that is controlling the whole thing that you're moving through in the first place. And this is like in 2003 or something on Homopoi, people are talking about this, 2004, 2005, whatever. Rev had taken that and thought about it differently, where he was focused on inside planes where the plane faces in at the torso. But as you can see, if you tilt this up here, if you take the torso out of the equation, you can still have inside pointing cross points, even though you don't have inside or outside planes really at that point, or I guess they're all outside planes, and have outside pointing cross points. And there's a variety of ways that we can break down how the planes and plane facing stack. So this is the other thing, again, basic first principles, the Lego blocks with which you build all the other play patterns up and the concepts up from here. As I was saying earlier, there are almost always like these reflective axes that we're interacting with. We might be flipping plane facings across one. We might even just be moving the stacking sights of our hands and poi across one. But if there is a plane up here and a plane down there, so it's two boundary planes that we can touch, that insinuates a midline, a midplane that is the reflective axis between these two. We want to explore the possible positions across that reflective axis. You can, it's pretty simple. You can stack one hand, you can have both hands together more or less on a plane as long as your poi don't collide. And you can have both hands on the other boundary plane as long as your poi don't collide. Or you can have one hand up, one hand down on either side of the reflective axis, or vice versa. And then you can also combine plane facing switches with that too. So what does that look like? You can have both plane facings facing up, both on the same plane, as long as they're not tangling, stacked. Both plane facings are the same direction, but one on either side of the reflective axis. Both plane facing the same direction, reciprocated, so now the other, you know, one is up, the other is down across the reflective axis. You can have both plane facings down, so the exact opposite of that last sequence. Both are down, as long as they don't tangle, they can be on the same plane. You can stack one above the other, or the reciprocal stack of that. And you can also have plane facings facing either direction. Now they're utterly mirroring each other across the reflective axis, not just in position, but in plane facings are mirrored now too. When you shift just the positions and not the plane facing, you go from an open kind of standard position where our poi are facing away from the reflective axis to a situation where the poi are facing the reflective axis. And this is what we think of as the buzzsaw plane, buzzsaw frame. They're facing through that reflexive plane in opposite directions in between the arm, in between the frame or hoop created by the armature. And that's essentially what Rev was thinking of as an inverted state. Now, of course, you can switch that up and flip the plane facings for this given stacking of the hands. So now we've got the other open situation, and if we don't change the plane facings, but we change the stacking, there's your other inversion. And so really, if you want to look at all this stuff, all the mills and weaves and inversions and inswings and all that, it's just sequencing. It's a matter of sequencing how you're stacking your planes and traveling between them, and how you're sequencing plane facing flips with the stacking sequence, and what time you're doing it at, such that you're sequencing where your cross points happen for those crossing flips. You're going to be doing something like this, it's just like a corkscrew, or we can be doing something like this, or we can be doing something like this. There's a ton of little variations that if you actually break it down that far, you'll discover all these different nuances. And depending on what realm you get into, we can potentially classify that as an inversion or an interversion moment or just a single inswing, so on and so forth. But all these words we're throwing around, concepts of, what's a Coleman, what's a wrong weave, what's an introversion, what's an inversion, how many degrees of twist an inversion, all that stuff that's concepts that are built up on top of these like little subatomic particles of basic poi movement. All those things, those are molecules. So you gotta understand the subatomic particles that make those up to really get it. And Rev did a lot of pioneering work with the manifesto and pretty clearly defining things, but there are inconsistencies and omissions. And that's partially because he was coming from a very weave-centric way of thinking and breaking it down from there. He was digging his way down through molecules and starting to see the relationship themes and starting scratch into, he got a good chunk of the way into thinking of the really basic elemental interactions, but didn't quite get it all the way there. I still haven't even fully articulated clearly the subatomic stuff. Okay, so let's look at some of this stuff. You're spinning here. You can choose to use two cross point sights to flip into a buzzsaw from this stacking position at the same time. And you can push both across. You can flip both at the same time, push both across. This, if we take out the rest beats in buzzsaw, we end up with one cross point in, one cross point out. You go the other way, you could pull across, then flip out, pull across, then flip out. You'll end up with this other one. Where one poi is using an inward cross point, one is using an outward cross point. In this case, the ones that are using inward pointing cross points are also, in this case, using in swings. Because Rev's the one who coined the term in swing. He defined it as swinging, the act of swinging in between the arms. It takes half a turn to get from out there, a reciprocal position, to fully pointing in between the arms. So we also have something coming from like a corkscrew, where there's a moment during the corkscrew where when you're untwisting and twisting in the corkscrew, that's when both plane faces are facing the same direction. So here's an important point. When you're spinning the same direction, twisting can only happen when both plane facings are pointing the same direction. So, twisting can't happen here in the poi. Twisting can't happen here in the poi. It's only when they're both facing the same direction that twisting can happen and untwisting can happen. So, during the moments in a corkscrew or a weave or whatever where you're untwisting, coming around, where you could start to twist, both plane facings are facing the same direction. From there, you can run a sequence where you shift stacking and flip plane facing in the buzzsaw. Then you flip the other plane facing and shift stacking back into the other half of a corkscrew. So that, you're probably familiar with it, that looks like this. So this is a basic inversion. This is a 0-degree inversion. It's not barrel rolling. There aren't degrees of twist yet. But this is, Rev defined inversions as a sequence of the poi doing an inswing one after the other from the same entry site. So in other words, going from one position to the same cross point. So that looks like just by virtue of shifting my hand stack, my plane stack, I've like sucked this boy into an in-swing and it didn't need a plane face and flip to get there. So here it in-swung. Now by plane facing flipping this one, that's the second in-swing. And they both did that from the same site. Timing-wise, they're coming from out, coming to in. They did it from this upper plane. So that switches. So this one switches. So this one switches plane site from here to here in a timing. So it goes from out to in. That's the first in swing. And now the second one, just by virtue of plane facing flip, uses the same timing half a turn later to get into buzzsaw. So this is a very simple form of repeated inversion. We could also go the other way. We could draw the other hand down, flip that hand in, flip this down, flip this down, flip this up. So I just reversed the sequence. I have not changed the direction my polar is spinning. And this is using an inward pointing cross point now, just like this two beat inward pointing at me. Now it's this hand, the left hand, is leading in. Because I reversed the sequence of sight switches and plane facing switches, it also forces timing wise to switch which cross point we use, which hand is the leader. Another thing to conceptualize is that when you're dealing with these chasing moves, these kind of helical chasing moves, I don't mean toroidal, I don't mean plane bending, I mean when poi moves through space in a parallel plane, it's drawing a helix, and that's actually what's happening when you're weaving multiple twists back and forth, or when you're inverting and doing barrel rolls, it's all kind of tracing a helix and then coming back on itself and tracing the helix back the other way. So with helical chasing moves, it's important to realize that where the plane facings are both facing out is like an end cap. And when there's an inversion, that's a middle layer, middle frame. And then on the other side where they're both facing out, that's another end cap. The end caps are where twisting happened, the middle layer is where inverting happens. And remember, when you have a in same direction, when you have inverted plane facings, when you have plane facings that are opposing each other, you can't twist. I jokingly like to think of it that, like, you know, the end caps are the cookies and the inversion in the middle is the ice cream. So here's an important point, like, introversions do not happen in between the arms and in inversion space. They're just taking and flipping the cookie inside out for a moment and then coming back out. So they're completely a separate component that can be end caps on either side of an inversion. So from corkscrew, to really fully demonstrate in swings, you kind of need to take it up to a 4-beat corkscrew so you actually do get across on the wrists. If you've got this cross and the poi planes are facing opposing, it's almost like this sort of position. So my right hand can in swing through to get untwisted, and then if I switch to the other position, again the right hand can swing through. Switch crossed, come through. So it looks like this. So right now, my right hand is running both possible in swings. I could also do it with the left hand. So pre-twist, I can be in this position, and I could use the left hand to in swing, switch position, use the left hand again to in swing, switch position,